can share these up. Brilliant. I think Tim now is going to engage the panel. He's got a series of questions. And keep in mind, they can't see because of the blinding lights. But afterwards, we'll have some question and answers as well.
So we have a panel that has particular expertise in nutrition and in some of the employment issues related to these topics. So I thought I'd give a couple of softball questions to each of the panelists, let them talk for 5 minutes or so, and then we'll start getting in some dialogue. So I'll start with you, Julie, if that's okay, because you're the first on my list. And my two questions for Julie, which she can answer in the most interesting way. I think what we care about more is, what is the most interesting thing you have to tell us? But my questions were, can you discuss the changes in demography in Africa and implications for youth employment? Well, let's just leave it at that. And then maybe, what is that regard to which types of agricultural endeavors we want to be doing?
Great, thanks, Tim. Well, you gave me a great lead-in with your presentation and your demographic points. I have just 5 points to make right now, and I look forward to hearing everybody's questions. I'm going to focus my remarks mainly on Africa, as you said, sub-Saharan Africa. First of all, let's think a little bit more about what Tim brought to us on demographic trends, especially in Africa. We've got a global population right now of 7.3 billion, expected to rise to 9.6 by 2050. And because of Africa's very slow demographic transition, the high fertility, and also progress in reducing childhood mortality, we're seeing sub-Saharan Africa is going to represent an increasing proportion of global population. So that is a marker. That population, growing proportion, that population is very young. It's very young right now, and it's very rural. So we expect to see in Africa 53% more people in rural areas by 2050. Currently, the population is very young. We have 200 million youth in sub-Saharan Africa between the ages of 15 and 24. And this is going to double, more than double, by 2050. So very young population, very rural population. What kind of opportunity and challenge does that really present to us? Opportunity is we have also an increasingly educated youth population. So with the growth of universal primary education and increasing access to secondary education, youth have a lot more potential than ever before to contribute to the economy. The flip side of that is we have an incredible looming employment challenge for these youth. And if we can't find economic opportunities for them, they frankly present some real risk for civil instability, such as we are seeing in parts of Nigeria and the Sahel region. So let's dissect a little bit those employment issues. We've got in sub-Saharan Africa, 11 million people entering the job market every single year. And, you know, the formal job creation is inadequate, you know, nicely said. Most of the burden of unemployment and underemployment is on youth right now. We have 60% of unemployment is youth unemployment. It's double the rate of adult unemployment. Okay, so looming employment challenge. Also, some opportunities there with increasing education of youth. So those are my 2 points. The third point is the agri-food system itself presents opportunities for youth employment in ways that I think the academic world, donors, I was formerly in the donor world, we really haven't been paying attention to that. You know, we've been thinking about employment opportunities for youth. We're thinking about, okay, structural transformation, people going to urban areas. Let's bring them into the trades. Let's bring them into the service industry. Let's train them into hotels and restaurants. We haven't looked so much at, you know, what's available for these youth in rural areas and in this rural to urban agri-food system linkage. So as Tim said, we have an incredible challenge, you know, in terms of not only a demographic challenge, but the need to produce more food. We do see in Africa a transition of labor moving out of rural areas, but still the absolute numbers of people in rural areas mean that for at least the next decade, most of the new jobs that are going to become available to youth are going to be on farm. So that means, you know, when I hear Tim talk about the challenges that we have for productivity, there's a real opportunity, you know, to wire in advanced agricultural technologies and work with youth to make sure that they are applying those agricultural technologies, that they're getting access to that applied information that you spoke about, and really mainstreaming those technologies on the farm. So I think that's a very positive thing, and frankly, you know, putting my former donor hat on, I just don't think we focused on this very much at all. You know, the whole issue of youth employment in agri-food systems is somehow under the radar. There are also rising opportunities, not only on-farm, but off-farm. So, Tim, you talked about rising demand for higher protein. And it doesn't have to be just beef. It can be fish. It can be chicken. It can be rabbit. Rising demand with urbanization and population shifts and rising income, rising demand for fresh products. So fresh vegetables, fresh fruits, we're seeing that. We're also seeing a rise in demand for processed. Processed has a bad connotation here, but processed can mean simply milled grains into flour. Seeing everywhere in sub-Saharan Africa, also the rise of prepared foods that you're able to access even in the small mini markets, and increasing consumption of food away from home in general. So this change in food composition, diet demand, and the way that foods are being consumed and where they're being consumed, those also present opportunities for youth employment that, again, we're not yet paying attention to. These job opportunities, in proportion, are growing very, very quickly, but from a low base. Yeah, so they can't match the absolute number of jobs that are coming on farm, but they are growing, and they are high-quality jobs, so real potential for youth to increase their incomes. So fourth point, and then I have one more point, and I'll hand back the microphone. So really thinking ahead, how do we capture for youth these opportunities? Both, I think we'll hear from some of the presenters, like Holo Tractor and Rick and Gandhi from Digital Green, about what are opportunities for youth throughout the farming system, so input supply, tractor provision, service provision. Think about opportunities for micro and small and medium-sized firms, from input supply all the way through to wholesale, processing, handling the logistics between farming and retailing. This should be a really appealing segment for youth. Again, largely has escaped notice. Finally, so what do we need to get started on this agenda? You know, and I do think it requires a pretty radical rethink of the donor community. So first of all, a mixed program strategy. You know, it's not a jump to, okay, you know, let's focus exclusively on off-farm activities. It's really, you know, how do we make agriculture more attractive to youth on the farm, you know, equip them with advanced agricultural technologies, and how to open their minds to understand what are the business opportunities throughout the system, and particularly in these emerging opportunities off the farm. Secondly, focus programming, especially on these value chains that are responding to the changing consumer demand. So value chains like horticulture and fruits and non-beef, higher protein. So manufacturing, port, service sectors. Addressing the policy as well as the skills challenges that youth face. So access to land and finance, those are things we always think of. Youth mindset transformation. You know, what kind of programs are needed so that youth don't continue to think of agriculture as, my gosh, you know, I want to run away as fast and far as possible. Hand-hoe agriculture is not for me. So what do we do, you know, to essentially open the vista of youth to these business opportunities through the value chain? This requires, I think, a very different approach to training than what we've traditionally taken. It's not just, you know, sit in a classroom and learn your thing and then go out and hope for the best. It's a much more experiential approach and a much deeper engagement of the private sector in determining, helping to determine what are the skills needed in the sector, what are the products, what can we foresee, what experiential opportunities can the private sector itself provide for youth coming in. So finally, attention to small, medium enterprise incubation. You know, I think that's really a game changer potentially in this sector. And I don't think we have a lot of insights on how to do this yet. But giving youth skills training, giving them access to finance, giving them ongoing policy help, but how to help them enter an almost an incubator type environment where they can experiment, where they can receive some ongoing guidance without the fear of falling flat.
Great. Well, that was very interesting. Emmy, let me go on to you. So this is a kind of a lead in to you talking about, I mean, part of this question is what kinds of agriculture need to be the focus? And you're an expert on the dietary consequences of these different issues. So why don't you give us some summary of your thoughts on, I would say, in general and in specifically, what are the changes you see are most needed to improve diets among those who are undernourished globally?
Thanks, Tim. I would like to just make one sort of starting point, which is that I think it's very, very difficult to think agriculture and then to think diet, because between the production side of agriculture and what it is people actually eat, there are lots of other steps. The food system is not just production and consumption. It is production, marketing, transport, processing, product development, advertising, marketing, labeling, and then consumer choice. How much money people have, whether they have jobs, what their cultural preferences are, what they want to eat. And I think these factors, thinking of it as a food system, which includes production, includes consumption, but includes a whole vast array of other actors, perhaps is a bit, in some ways, a more interesting way, in a more comprehensive way, of thinking about the challenges that you put forward, Tim, where you left out, for example, waste and loss, I mean, which is one of the things people have said, if we can reduce waste and loss in the and increase the efficiency of food moving through the supply chain, and food not rotting in people's refrigerators, we will in fact sort of meet some of that increase in effective availability that you were talking about. So I think that I would like to talk about sort of the relationship between the food systems operation and people's diets, because in fact, what we often call poor diets, and this is the thing here, are now considered to be the greatest contributor to the global burden of disease. The measurement of this, I challenge any of you to go through the methodology as an Aggie. I've read a lot of FAO stuff, but when you start getting into how the DALYs, the Disability Adjusted Life Years methodology work, it kind of stretches your brain in another direction. But the fact is that there are poor diets of three sorts which are out there now and which are in fact contributing to this global burden of health. One is what we often think of, which is, in some ways you were talking about this, undernutrition. Too few calories to actually support productive, healthy lives. That's what we talk about, the hunger index, we talk about starving children. It's the image that people comes for almost first to people's minds when they talk about poor diets. But in fact, there are today maybe 700, 800 million people in this world who are chronically undernourished by FAO estimations. And there are, at the same time, about 2 billion people who are overnourished, eating too many calories, eating too much red meat, eating a wrong, an incorrect balance of foods. And indeed, the number of people in the world today who are eating poor diets because they are deficient in critical micronutrients is also about 2 billion, maybe 2.2 billion. The numbers are really, and thanks to LSMS, we actually have some better numbers on this, but the numbers are still a little dicey with regard to micronutrient malnutrition. And I hope that Adewale will address that a little bit. So we have three kinds of poor diets. We have undernutrition, we have overnutrition for overweight that is resulting in overweight and obesity, and we have micronutrient malnutrition, which is often called hidden hunger. I don't like that phrase, but you'll see it sometimes in the literature. And because each of these is the result, each of these is co-occurring in a food system, we have to think about what it is in that food system that needs to change in order to be able to do it. And you specifically asked me what I would most recommend to change, improve diets among those who have poor diets. And you obviously have to think sort of three large target groups, right? And each of those issues, and we can go into this, requires kind of a different approach. If you're addressing undernutrition, that's a way different problem than if you're addressing obesity. But let me point to sort of three things that I think, as sort of a matter of general principle, can be thought about. And the first one is informed leadership. And that sounds like, oh yeah, right, the president's responsible for what people eat. But in fact, the presidents, the prime ministers, who are aware of the relationship between the food system and the diet quality of their populations will also be concerned about how that poor quality diet leads to issues which are politically destabilizing, have an impact on the quality, the labor productivity of their labor force, and have an impact on actually government budgets in terms of healthcare. We can go into those in more detail if you want. I wanted to tell a quick story because I was at the AGRA meeting in Nairobi in September, and we had a meeting of the global panel with a number of people, including former presidents Kikwete and Obasanjo. And President Kikwete told a story about sort of his first realization as an adult, and he said, yeah, this was kind of amazing that he was already a grown man, about the relationship between food and diet and health. And he said he grew up in a coastal town in Tanzania, and they did a lot of fishing, they ate a lot of seafood, except for his mother. His mother absolutely hated the smell of fish and refused to eat it. His mother also had a very large goiter, indicating a lack of iodine consumption. Iodine, an important micronutrient for thyroid, for growth, for healthy living. And he said, I was the minister of mines. He was a grown man. I was the minister of mines, and a friend came up to me and he said, you know, Kikwete, I would like to share a video with you. And it was a video about iodine and how it caused goiter. And Kikwete said, here I was, I should have known this, you know, because I'd seen my mother all my life with this very disfiguring disease. And he said, then my friend said to me, you can do something about it. He said, me? He said, yeah, you're the Minister of Mines. You can lead on formulating a regulation for the government of Tanzania that all salt in this country should be iodized. And you will eliminate goiter, such as your mother has, in this country. He said, for me, it was just like this light bulb moment. Food, diet, your taste preferences, his mother not liking the smell of fish, and the relationship to your actual physical health condition. He said, as that person then, when I became president, I really made it a point for Tanzania to become one of the members of Scaling Up Nutrition, an international movement really focusing on nutrition. And he's very supportive of leadership that Akin Anasina, one of my global panel member colleagues, has been putting forward from his role in African Development Bank for a group called African Leaders for Nutrition. Actually saying that it is important for political leaders to take on these issues that you talked about, Tim, to take on that sort of, that intellectual understanding of the relationship between food, consumption, diet, health, and to sort of figure out how to set up a food system in which the interventions are there. Can I make one other point on this? And the story, I think, also illustrates, I think, a key point that a good diet, as opposed to a poor diet, a healthy diet, a high-quality diet, really is more than calories. Because, in fact, it does involve kind of people's social behavior. Any folks here from Kenya, probably? The idea that, and this goes to your point about eating less red meat, if that having a big family party and not having nyama choma, that might be a little tricky, right? But the question is, and this is one of the other points that the global panel has come up with, is balance. You know, it's not enough to be, you know, the finger pointer and say, you are bad because you had a steak. But it's to say, sure, once a year you can have a nyama choma, have your big family party, but that should not be your regular diet 5 days a week. The last, I think, point that I do want to point out is that while we throw these numbers out, 700, 800 million people chronically hungry, 2 billion overweight and obese, 2.2 billion with micronutrient malnutrition, we should also recognize that we often say, well, there's an exception, that people in countries that are in conflict, well, they're a special case. But I have to tell you that people in countries in conflict never, ever have good diets. And so that whole challenge of eating, that whole challenge of having food systems that provide at least minimal nutrition, minimal nutrients to countries in conflict, I think is one of the challenges that we, who are not just in agriculture, but part of that food system, really need to take into account. Because the kids in South Sudan won't recover. They are going to be affected for life by the diet they eat now. The kids from Syria who are picking vegetables in Lebanon in order to feed their families, they will not recover.
Okay, well, thanks very much. Terrific.
So Chris, let's turn to you. Chris, you're going to, tell us a little bit about what the World Business Council is doing. And I've challenged you to say, okay, give us some of the best specific examples of what's going on. And I think there are a couple of slides.
Sure. So I was a little overzealous. I had put some slides together, so I promise not to bore you with too many details. But so we have a new initiative called FRESH, which is Food Reform for Sustainability and Health. You can go to the next slide. So this is WBCSD. In case you don't know who we are, this is the easiest way to explain us. We're basically 190 global Fortune 500 companies, created 20 years ago to be kind of the business voice with the UN, with the multilaterals, in that there was a recognition that the business community was not at the table, literally. One of the things, and I think, you know, you used the term, the light bulb moment. One of the light bulb moments, I think, for us and then our membership has been about 3 years ago. We had all of a sudden a rush of new companies joining WBCSD. We've always been heavily industrial. But the new companies joining us have all come from the ag and food sectors. And that has really been eye-opening because that has not historically been the type of companies that would join us. And generally, the way companies or why companies have joined us was to create, in a sense, the political courage or the economic courage to move forward, because where companies on their own did not want to, collaboratively they could. So we had always sectoral initiatives in forestry or in chemicals or in cement, et cetera. So now food and ag is kind of the big area, and all the new, I would say majority of the new members have come from that sector. This year alone, for instance, Danone, Archer Daniels Midland, and Rabobank all joined us in January, for instance. Next slide. So we have a number of initiatives now, and I'm just going to very quickly just mention them. So Moore Foundation has this catalytic funding arrangement where they are looking at global commodity markets, particularly on the agricultural side, on soy and beef, and on the seafood, particularly shellfish, and then on looking at how the financial markets evaluate and assess the risks, whether they're actually looking at the risks that potentially global commodities are under from a stress point of view, from an ability to source, et cetera. In addition, we have a Climate Smart Agricultural Initiative, which is about 2 years old. It was created for Paris for the climate discussions, because the idea was that agriculture, as we heard very eloquently from Tim, is agriculture has a huge opportunity from, and or problem from land use change, et cetera. How do we actually change that? How do we actually get the agricultural companies to be seen as part of the solution? Similar to how forestry was, say, 10 years ago, where forestry was almost universally viewed as part of the problem, which was one of the impediments for, say, getting the Kyoto Protocol approved. How do we actually get agriculture to be recognized as a solution orientation as opposed to a source of global emissions? That is led, that initiative is being led by five companies now. Rabobank, it's Monsanto, Kellogg's is part of it, but Pepsi, Kellogg's, and Olam are the leading companies. And then Fresh, I'm going to talk about in a second. Global Agribusiness Alliance is an alliance of growers. Olam CEO had launched this last year. And this is looking at particularly deforestation issues and water issues. And then the brand new one is the Soft Commodities Forum, which I'm actually heading up, which is working with the ABCD, so the Archer Daniels Midland, Bungie, Cargill, Louis Dreyfus, the big four commodity traders, and looking at where they're seeing pressure, both from a sourcing side and then as well from their customers. So in essence, the Unilevers, the Kellogg's, and all the world are asking for very specific details on how this soy, for instance, is sourced and developed. Next slide. So we've formed an affiliation with the EAT Foundation. If you haven't heard of the EAT Foundation, they're based in Stockholm. The EAT Foundation is really looking at, rather than farm to fork, fork to farm, and really focused on consumer choices and how do we work with consumers on diets. They have formed a relationship with the Stockholm Resiliency Center and the Lancet, the medical publication out of the UK, to really look at the health issues around food. And we have, so if they are, in essence, you could say, gonna look at the overarching side of food from the point of view of the science, and if you could take the climate analogy, there's an IPCC for science, but there isn't anything like that on food science. How do we actually look at the major food issues and try to figure out what the consensus points are behind that? Below that, we will and are convening companies around various verticals, which I'll talk about in a second, where companies can potentially add their expertise and perhaps change their business models to kind of reflect the need to meet the science. Next slide. You can skip this one. So Fresh, our new initiative, the uniqueness of it is a business engagement. 100% of food is privately sourced. So how do this is a major lever of change, opportunity for the business community. Scale, impact, the network. So it's we really want to be collaborative. We're looking for partners. We're looking to bring in points of view. And anyone who is potentially interested, please see me afterwards. We'd love to see how we can involve others in here. Next slide.
So let me challenge you then.
Sure.
We're running out of time. Give us your one or two best examples of what you think is going on that's exciting that people should know about.
The one is the commodity side. I think that's actually a really interesting opportunity because the global commodities have these two pressure points. One on the pressure side is that a Unilever or a Kellogg's are asking for very specific detailed orientation as to where the soy is, for instance, being sourced by a Cargill. But Kellogg's might be asking for a very different set of questions. So in essence, it's actually potentially decommoditizing the commodity. And so if you're the commodity traders, this isn't actually a good business model because each one is now having to be kind of earmarked for each, right, and the traceability side and all. So the idea is can we actually maybe lift all boats by having the global commodity guys reach kind of a consensus as to what are the key sustainability issues that they're actually able to potentially tackle. So maybe we can reach a 90% consensus point on what the questionnaires are that they're receiving from a Unilever or a Kellogg's or whoever. And then work from there to kind of use that as the maybe the industry standard then that could be created that others would follow.
Great. Okay.
These are the areas that Fresh is focused on. I won't read them off to you, but you can see we are focused on food waste, for instance, and productivity, sustainable diets, and healthy lifestyles.
Great. Well, thanks very much, Chris. Terrific. So Adewale, whom I just met now, you're an expert, I think, on biofortification, is my understanding. So I want to ask you, what are the most exciting technical opportunities that you see? What are the most important investments that we need in that area?
Thank you, Tim. First, I'd like to thank the World Bank for having Harvest Plus represented here today. And also, I'd like to thank the organizer also for having me to share my thoughts on biofortification. I don't want to go ahead with the assumption that everybody actually know what biofortification is. So I'll start by emphasizing that the linkages between agriculture and health has tremendous opportunities for addressing global challenges, so that eating hunger, as Amy mentioned. But as we have seen from various, from different speaker, our current food system is not well positioned to actually help us address this challenge. Therefore, we need to look for more innovative approaches. And today, I'm going to introduce you to an innovation that is simple, but very powerful and sustainable, and that is biofortification. It is an innovation that has the capacity to help the world reduce the high cost of delaying the reduction in micronutrient malnutrition. Without going into the rhetorics of statistics because of time, we all know the great implication of having iron deficiency, for example. Lack of iron in diet leads to low cognitive development, which has implications in educational attainment for children in developing countries. And that has wider economic impact in terms of the socioeconomic development of a population. So, several different approaches have been tried to address this challenge. We have commercial food fortification. But as you know, 70% of the current world poor live in the rural areas. Therefore, many of them are unable to access nutritious food like animal source protein or fruit vegetables. Also, supplementation has been tried. It's been proven to be an effective targeted nutrition intervention that improves child survival. However, this intervention is usually driven by international donor and NGOs, which means the coverage is varies year on year. So I can go on and on. Of course, the ideal situation is for us to push on dietary diversity, right? However, considering the current infrastructure state in majority of developing world, where majority of the malnourishment is located, rural poor are still not going to be able to access this diverse diet within in the short term. So something has to be done. The solution is complex, but can be achieved. Nutrition starts from what people eat, and that's agriculture. It all starts with a seed. And a seed is a very powerful thing, and that's our innovation. We simply cross old forgotten varieties that have high concentration of micronutrients like vitamins and minerals and cross them with high yielding new varieties of the same crop to get new crops that are high yielding and at the same time richer in micronutrient content. Our various crops, such as vitamin A maize or vitamin A sweet potato or iron beans, they have the capacity to provide between 25% and 100% of daily requirement. This is our innovation. So going back to a specific example of how biofortification is currently already making a difference, we have conducted several efficacy trials as well as effectiveness studies in Uganda, in Rwanda, for different age groups, for children between the age of less than 5 years or adolescent in India as well. we have found out that regular consumption of biofortified crop does reverse iron deficiency for women of childbearing age. And at the same time, in Rwanda, for example, within the 4 months of consuming regularly iron beans, their iron deficiency was reversed. And we have on and on different results or evidence to show that biofortification is not only efficacious, but also very cost-effective strategy. Because all you need is one-time investment, and then the seed continue to be grown year on year and still provide the same nutrients. So in terms of technical opportunities, our goal is that we want to reach about 1 billion people by 2030. As by the end of 2016, we have been able to reach 20 million people who are currently growing and consuming biofortified crops across the world. So in order for us to reach this 1 billion people, we cannot do it alone. We need partnership. And that is why we reach out to great partners like the World Bank in order for us to be able to mainstream nutrition into agricultural program across country. That's number one opportunity. We need to be able to enhance.
Okay, so give us, what are your five top opportunities? So.
Okay, I'm going around that now. So I'm just gonna, you know, like segregate them into three concepts. Okay. First, we have to look at the government, and secondly, we have to look at the private sector, and thirdly, we have to look at the consumers. First thing we have to do is that we have to be able to ensure that governments are aware of biofortification and that they are able to integrate biofortification into agricultural plans. And one of the vehicles to be able to do that, for example, is different financial instruments, for example, through the World Bank, can be used to create awareness among the government about biofortification. And secondly, we need to be able to mainstream biofortification into the breeding programs for NAS, for different organizations as well. And in order to do that, we need to build the capacity of the government to be able to utilize biofortification technology effectively so that it can have impact on their population. For example, one of the challenges that we have currently is to be able to operationalize regional crop release regulation. For example, like SADC has Seed Harmonization Act, which means that if you release a crop in one country, then you should be able to release it in other once you can prove that it's been tested in two of other countries that are member of the regional organization, then you should be able to release the crop. But these regulations are not operationalized. So government needs to be assisted to be able to operationalize such opportunities. Secondly, we need to be able to ensure that we engage the private sector across all the stages, from the seed development, seed marketing, to food processing. For us to be able to reach our scaling target of reaching 1 billion, we have to be able to work effectively with the private sector. And lastly, referring back to your initial presentation about increasing efficiency, increasing productivity. Biofortified crops are as high yielding as current varieties now. And they are designed to be climate smart. So biofortification is just like an hanging fruit. Basically, we're not replacing what is in the system. We are just improving the food system.
Okay, so five top crops.
So the five top crops is vitamin A sweet potato, vitamin A maize, iron beans, iron pea millet, zinc rice in Bangladesh.
Terrific.
And Pakistan.
Terrific. So look, I think we're now at the time where we really should go to questions.
Yes.
And why don't we take two at a time, and I might throw in something additional while
just
we're
just before you go, can we all stand up for a moment, please? Come on, everybody stand up and give a big round of applause to these guys. We're not done yet. Now. And we know we have to shake it out. Come on, we knew this from yesterday. Let's go shake it out. Now, do you remember we did this? Now, come on, everybody, up and down. Let's get the blood flowing here. All right, now, as you're doing that, shaking, I'm not going to get you to shake on some other places. But anyways, we're going to take, if you asked a question yesterday, don't ask a question today, just to allow others. What I love about this group is you're already moving ahead, but let's make those questions only one, not multiple layer questions. Let's just make it a 1-point question. We're going to open the floor, then Tim will help moderate and see the questions. So put up your hands if you'd like a question, and there's one here. We'll start here. We'll take two microphones. Everybody can sit down. There's one at the back, Simeon, and one. We'll do 1-2 for now. Where are those microphones? And my colleagues will help me. One here and one there. Very good. Good, good. We're all loose now. We're ready for you.
Am I the first?
Shook it out.
Shall I start?
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
Jonathan and I, we're going to sing. No, thank you very much for this great presentation from different people. I'm happy to see good friends sitting there, Julie and others, Amy and so on. So it's really great. My first question, or my question, is focusing really on the first presentation, on the livestock part, okay? And it's reminiscent of many of the discussions that some of us have had, you know, in the past, in mid-80s, you know, when we were discussing how to support and fund, you know, livestock, particularly in Africa. I think there continues to be some amalgamation of issues affecting basically the livestock farmers, particularly in Africa. Don't get me wrong, I agree, agriculture, including livestock, contributes significantly to greenhouse gas emissions. There's no question about that. Everybody knows about it. Also, overconsumption of red meat and so on can lead to, you know, health problems, and that's correct. However, I think when we make our, you know, when we make recommendations, and so we need to be a little bit balanced and try to see how, you know, to look at the different situations. What do we have? We have a situation where some of the analysis that we are making are being made from the perspective of the richer countries like here, you know, where we see, you know, overconsumption of meat and translating that into a situation that's happening in many developing countries.
Buona Simeon, okay, not yeah. a long question.
Okay, so
it's
going to be very short.
Okay.
What I want to basically say is that it is very important, you know, to understand that in many of the developing countries, you cannot make a recommendation based on stopping or reducing consumption, because that's really the revolution that's happening. The question is not about that. The question is really about how we can use science, you know, to actually help to promote practices that can actually help to reduce the emission of gases and so from livestock production.
Okay.
It's not
right.
really
Good.
About, you okay. know, reduce consumption.
Okay, so your question is about right. consumption versus production focuses.
Right.
So why don't we
right
get our second
now.
Question.
Excellent.
Thank you. I'm Jonathan Wadsworth, and must admit I'm a livestock scientist by training. Mm-hmm. The sort of theme of, I would ask a question. It relates to what Simeon just said, but it's a scientific, technical question, and there's more than one person on the platform that I hope can say something about this. What's stopping us, rather than tweaking around the edges of the livestock problem, what's stopping us from really producing synthetic meat from vegetable products and microbes and all the sorts of things?
Very nice.
I believe that the food technologists are fairly close to this, but you tell me what you think. Is it a scientific endeavor worth pursuing or not?
Yeah. Good. Okay, well, I'll give a quick answer to these and then ask the panelists. So in order to kind of find a possible path to achieving all the food we need at acceptable emissions and land use, I don't know of a single modeler who hasn't had to assume some dietary change. So in our analysis, we are projecting a
So right now, if you assume you start at 100% of beef production, of beef consumption, you go up to 180%, you can't get there. If the world produces at 180% of present beef consumption, there's just no way. No matter how efficiently we produce beef, we're not going to get there. So we imagine a one-third cut from that, which means you have like a 30 or 40% growth. So you're still producing more beef, but you have to have this cut. So that the real question is, I think you need both. You need the improvements in efficiency and some reduction in the rate of growth. But I think the real question in Africa is, are you focusing on beef or are you focusing on other livestock products? So beef is just off the charts. Beef and ruminant meat are off the charts in terms of their land use demands and their emissions relative to milk, pork, chicken, eggs. And so that's really the question. I think, so yes, I mean, you're absolutely right that we need, as a whole, it would be better if Africa actually, and parts of the developing world, have larger increases in livestock consumption than projected by FAO. But if it comes in the form of beef, there's just no solution. Regarding the artificial meat, I think it's a critical solution here, but it's mostly going to come from vegetable, better ways of turning soy and other vegetables into meat. I don't think it's going to come from this kind of test tube meat. And people are getting closer. And particularly if you're talking, I had something the other day that was kind of, we did a test at Princeton, we had a conference, where you had a different burgers of different types, and one was half vegetable and half beef, and you just couldn't. It was better than all beef, even if you like beef. So there's lots of opportunities, I think, to substitute in that direction. Does anyone else want to comment on that?
I was just going to say, just kind of quickly, in all the initiatives we have engaging the corporate world, one of the things that's really been daunting for us is, for whatever reason, we have not been able to get the protein providers to participate in any way, shape, or form. And I think that is telling in the sense there's almost a lack of willingness to recognize the problem in the sense that it affects their business model so thoroughly. What we have seen, though, is some market movement. And one of the ones that caught my eye recently was, I think it was Tyson Foods has invested in a company called Beyond Meat. And the idea that, there is actually now this idea, this movement toward the kind of more entrepreneurial approaches and buying companies that potentially have kind of more innovative business models than some of the big companies. And a lot of the large food companies, what we're seeing is, have created these entrepreneurial funds. Campbell Soup is a good example of that, for instance.
Just a quick comment. So I think actually climate change and the climate instability presents certain opportunities in terms of shift of meats. So I was just at a conference in Tanzania last week, and having some of my younger colleagues come to me and say, you know, it's so risky right now. I mean, to start a beef enterprise, or you're at such peril, you know, with climate, that it's actually a good time to work with young people on production of rabbit and production of poultry and fish, you know. So these things are, demand is expanding anyway, you know, but work with it. So I think that's one point. So Jonathan, I'm wondering if by synthetic products, do you also mean like soy? So, I mean, in some senses, increased soy consumption is a kind of meat substitution. And I frankly, you know, have been pretty amazed at how soy is starting to take off in some markets in sub-Saharan Africa. So you're increasingly seeing soy milk products and soy yogurts, and that being marketed, first of all, to the, you know, the consumer class in the capitals. But you can see that demand is spreading out. So, you know, I think I'm not ready to offer an opinion yet on engineered meats, but it's promising that you're seeing other kinds of high-quality protein substitutes coming in.
So why don't we get another couple of questions?
Let's see. We've got one here and one at the very back on 22. No, the person in front. And we've got one here. I just want to also say, obviously, you have a lot of expertise out here as well. For instance, Simeon is a livestock expert. And I know there'll be some engagement that you'll want to have. So I do apologize for cutting some of my esteemed colleagues short. But we'll make the questions.
Why don't we take three questions now and keep them a little short if possible so that we can...
Hi, Tim. No.
And introduce yourself, even though everyone knows you.
My name is Chris Delgado, and in full disclosure, Tim and I have been colleagues in the past, and I guess we are now too. But no polemics, but it's a genuine question, which is, you have addressed the issue primarily in terms of mitigation, and of course at a global scale, that makes lots of sense. But in Africa, where many of us work, there's a real concern about resilience. And in certain parts of Africa, cattle in particular have been a theme that, if you like, a resilience theme that have allowed people to live in zones they couldn't live in otherwise. And I might add, from a livestock point of view, small ruminants are far more destructive of vegetation than cattle are. So I wanted to ask you to comment on the relationship of your recommendations to resilience, at least in parts, just to the general resilience question. And I might add, you know, rabbits are fine, but they have to eat something, and the question is, you know, we're talking about zones where that is not probably going to be very feasible if you're really in rural areas.
Excellent. There was one at the very back, I think table 22, and did we have another one? Let's say this, and you, sir, will be the third. Yeah. And just tell us again who you are, which area you are in. Yeah, please.
Brian Bedard. I'm with the GMA Science and Education Foundation, formerly the World Bank, and familiar faces. Hello. I'd like to build on Dr. Howard's comment around youth, and particularly around education. If we're really looking at the future and we want to drive practices and change behaviors in the future, I haven't heard much about education. I mean, we do a lot of work because we're working in that space around middle schools in particular, because those are the formative years. If you're looking at changing diets, how are we looking at that in the perspective of driving behavioral change and education so that they look at alternative diets around fish and things other than beef, for example? Is anybody really driving that agenda towards education of the future generations? Thank you.
And that last question, yes, that goes. Now, I see that I made a little confusion and offered two of you up a question. So
we'll take four. What the heck?
We'll take four. So you go ahead, sir, and then we had you here. Good.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
Good morning.
Only have 10 minutes. Oh, no.
Good morning. Pierre Gerber. Working at the in the IGP in the South Asia region, especially on livestock and climate change questions. Tim, I think we all agree that there are kind of three main entrances to mitigation. One is consumption, the other one is efficiency gain, the other one is land use change. I would say you painted a little bit of a gloomy picture, maybe, on efficiencies. I think the yield gap in the sector is still huge. It's a sector that has grown by expansion more than by yield gains, contrary to the crop sector. So probably there is maybe a little more than you showed there. I would say on the land use change, we could also speak about sequestration. You don't mention it too much. There might be some sequestration potential, especially where we're talking about degraded land and restoration of degraded land. But my question really comes to the demand side. And I really believe, as you, that it's part of the thing. And it's probably true to make a general statement that in areas where livestock consumption is growing, we should grow out of ruminant species. Okay. But from that to making recommendations, there is a huge gap. There is culture, there is resilience, there is the fact that cattle are suitable for the management of certain ecosystems. So we need a lot of distinction here, and we need a lot of disaggregation of these policies. So here, maybe to Chris and to Amy, a question. In your work, what has been the thinking about influencing demand and talking about different targets in that regard?
We'll take one more question, and the reality is we're going to be done in 10 minutes, so a very quick question. We'll just try and have some points here, and the question was coming up to this gentleman here. It was the final question. Make it very brief, if you wouldn't mind.
Vikas Chaudhary, Global Engagement Unit. So in this session, we are basically trying to imagine the future, and we are still sticking to food with land. Is there a possible future in 2050, 2100 where food is actually produced in petri dishes and laboratory and pharmaceutical companies in forms of just popping up pills that gives you the required energy, the required nutrient, the required everything that is needed? I would just like to hear
so
what
panel
think about
great
that.
A great set of questions. I think my brief cut, I completely agree with the idea about disaggregating your livestock sector. And in Africa, of course, we have these pastoral areas, and they're going to continue to be pastoral areas, and they should continue to provide ruminant outputs. They are a small fraction of the total meat and milk that comes even in Africa, and there's not that much potential to grow their production because actually native grazers or indigenous grazers are actually fairly efficient. So I don't think we're talking about them. We're talking about other sectors where you have mixed farming where you can do a lot more, where you really have to have a focused alternative to beef. And just on the last question, I'll say the answer is basically no. There might be some opportunities to do, you know, high value products, but when you look at the, I mean, you just have to think about, so I'll give you just two quick numbers. If you try to raise production in a vertical setting and then provide the energy supply, and then you, let's say you want to make the energy from bioenergy, you would need a minimum of 1,000 to 2,000 hectares of land for every 1 hectare of land that you're growing vertically, or 1 hectare of platform that you're using vertically. So the answer is no. There, you know, when you're using half the world's land to produce food, the chance of actually providing a large fraction of the world's food in a more contained setting is, I think, no. So I'll pass the baton to.
Can I talk about demand?
Yeah.
Influencing demand, and then because I want to do it before you do it. Influencing demand, I think, is an important way to start, because often we think about culture, you know, cultural food patterns as locked in, but the work of Reardon and Dave Shirley and Berdegay are pointing out that in fact diets are changing, and diets are changing fast, but they're not actually right now changing in a healthier direction. In fact, people are looking, as urbanization continues, people are looking for more convenience, more ready-prepared food, things that they can just eat quickly on their way to or from work. I think there's a growing realization that paying attention to how demand patterns are shaped by education, looking at the Brian in the back there, and how schools increasingly have a role to play as populations become more urbanized, how schools have a role to play in shaping the food habits of the next generation. So I think there's a whole new set of thinking about school feeding, which people used to say, well, you need to give kids, you know, meals at school to keep them awake and to keep them learning. But it's not only that, it's actually proactively using that eating opportunity to enable kids to learn what good food is, because a lot of kids today in Europe, in the US, even in many African countries, where obesity is growing among middle-class kids, are not eating well, and schools are a place to do it. We should also not underestimate, and this is why I said I wanted to speak before Chris, the whole impact of social media and marketing efforts in terms of shaping taste, in terms of shaping consumer views, and shaping what consumers demand. You know, is it GMO? Is it cage-free? Is it antibiotic-free, et cetera? And consumers these days, because of social media, are able to articulate their voices, to organize, and to actually drive production in new directions, and I think we need to pay attention to that.
Got about 5 minutes, folks.
Okay, the last thing I just want to make, and I'll pass it on, is taxation. Because one of the areas of poor diets that really has bloomed or flowered or whatever has been in the area of sweetened beverages, full calorie Coke, full calorie Pepsi, some of the businesses that are members of this group. And governments are beginning to realize that just allowing open markets to operate in this area may in fact be irresponsible, and that considering using taxation to alter the price choice, the price opportunities, or the price options facing consumers may be a way to influence demand. Now, I'm not suggesting that, in fact, we start taxing hamburgers, but I think as an influence on demand, we really do need to take into consideration price.
Yeah. So just quickly, Brian, thank you very much for your question. I think there is a need for a pretty dramatic rethink of the role of schools at every level in the agriculture and nutrition sector. So when we were doing some work with MasterCard Foundation, and first of all, they've challenged Michigan State in this whole area. Don't just think of this as a research project. We also want you to figure out how to apply your lessons from the research in the field, which we've accepted in Nigeria and Tanzania. In doing the research in Nigeria and Tanzania, I was pretty shocked to talk with private sector who said, you know, please, I am not going to hire anybody from local universities or local polytechnics, because not only do they not have the skills that I need them to have, they come equipped with attitude, which means I need to pay them more, and then I need to retrain them. So I'd rather start with a blank slate. That's a pretty telling indictment. On the how do we initiate this behavioral change and just reinforce Emmy's point, it's not all about formal education. It's also about, you know, how do we more purposefully use social media and lifelong education to reach youth and continuing into adulthood with information and a platform to communicate with themselves. I think that's another area where we're really in danger of missing an important opportunity. On behavioral change in terms of primary and secondary school, I was delighted in Tanzania last week to talk with one of our project partners there, which is the Sokoine University Graduate Agricultural Graduate Entrepreneurs Cooperative. They have a training camp that they're operating in central Tanzania, where they are training university graduates to become agricultural entrepreneurs. And strictly as an organic side project, they decided, well, you know, let's take the secondary school that's nearby, and let's go plant a vegetable garden, and let's see what happens. And it's been phenomenally successful. You know, and it's a business. They're actually substituting what students would have to pay in school lunches. They're dialoguing with these entrepreneurs, so it's working on every level. But it's got nothing to do with anything that the existing school system thought up. So anyway, good points.
Yeah, sure. A lot of thoughts. Emmy actually hit on a couple of interesting items there. In that. One of the reasons we created the Fresh Initiative is that we had been looking through our other initiatives from the production side. We were interested in Fresh and working with the EAT Foundation because it was looking at the consumer engagement side and how to change consumer behavior. And so one of the interesting things, and it's brand new, so I can't really cite the real examples yet behind it, but what's interesting is the companies that have been really interested, and you can see the companies that have already signed up, Google would stick out, for instance. We've had conversations with companies like Facebook, who have been very interested because of what they're seeing in interest from their users from the social media side. And then I would say as well, what you see now is on this kind of what we hit on a little earlier was this entrepreneurial side, is that, you know, the Kellogg's of the world, not Kellogg's, the Campbell Soups of the world will tell you that they're not seeing growth in their traditional soup business. Where they're seeing the growth is in the Boathouse Farms and the healthy chefs and the other areas that they've been investing in, and the same thing for Kellogg's with Kashi, for instance. So that's where we're seeing these opportunities to kind of change demand.
Last points here.
The last point I just want to make is, you know, great points. I just want to cite an example of what we have done in terms of education, for example, how we're driving nutrition education. One of the things that Akin Adesina, when he was the Minister of Agriculture in Nigeria, was able to help us achieve was to actually help us mainstream biofortification into educational program as part of the policy. So it was a great opportunity for us. And secondly, Africans love to watch movies. They love to, especially Nigerians are driving a lot of the movie industry in Africa. So one of the things we've taken advantage of is actually to produce a movie about vitamin A cassava, about vitamin A maize. And that movie actually won an award last year. So a lot of opportunities around this. And for example, in terms of the school, we started something called Nutri-Quiz. among secondary school students, where they compete, and we are supported by Nestle and different private sector. I just wanted to share a couple of examples. Thanks.
So I want to thank the panel, and let me.
Yeah, keep going. I think they'll turn it on.
Okay, and maybe just throw out one idea that was at least stimulated by the multiple contributions, which are there reasonable opportunities for value-added, employment-heavy agricultural production in rural sectors that would contribute alternatives to livestock products, or as well as more efficient livestock products in a highly nutritious way? Is there a sector, is there a growth opportunity in the rural sectors for some kind of value-added livestock alternative product? And soy-based, but processing, things that give people additional choice. So that would be one of the thoughts that you get from following this.
Awesome.
So I'll bring this panel to a close. And
excellent. And can we have a big round of applause? Yeah. Excellent. Thank you so much. That was so much food for thought there. As they're heading down, we're going to break. We're going to for coffee. We're going to come back at 11 o'clock sharp for a very interesting session. All those people who are in the upcoming session, all the presenters, would you please meet me up here? Otherwise, enjoy your coffee. One more round of applause for this group.